Hello there. Right, it is time for Aspects of Star Wars, Episode 4, A New Hope. And I'm dealing with woodwind voices at the moment. This one is about 2M4, R2, that cue, then 3M1, the princess appears, and then a little bit of 3M2, lost R2, but better known as Binary Sunset, essentially. We'll go through them, and they basically just get more and more complex. I was trying to find something by Brahms, and I can't find anything, but basically this sort of configuration where you have the main melody doubled in octaves and then a third below is quite a pianistic texture, but he tends to use it quite a lot in woodwind voicing and also in violins as well. So it's something to bear in mind. It's a very sort of pianistic thing where you have your thumb here, fifth finger and third finger there. We'll make a start. So pretty simple, really. Just everything stacked, block chordal homophony, three flutes, all in root position until we get to here, really, first inversion. There is a seventh chord there. Three bassoons, again, all stacked in good registers as well. Eventually it goes into first inversion and then second inversion as well. That's it. Just an example of sort of stacking. And that is from 2M4, which I think is this one. So it's this particular cue. So the only thing left was just that little run in flute one. And then it's stacked in octaves with bassoons. And that's it. It's simple as that, and just sort of pizzicato strings pretty much all the way through as well. It's a really, really short cue. So that is that. That's covered. Then we go into 3M1, The Princess Appears, which is this sort of rather sort of pleading, help me Obi-Wan Kenobi type sort of thing. Which is interesting. The piece starts off with this very familiar thing. And then we just got a long pedal with strings. So we can see two flutes, then flute, clarinet one and clarinet two. Then a mixed timbre in a minute. And then the Brahms. Like that. It's just that at the beginning. So bearing in mind that's what's going on. So we've got flute one and flute two on these little bits, and they're just in thirds. Like that. And then we've also got clarinet one and clarinet two. So pretty simple enough, and the celeste doubles all of them. Where it gets interesting is this little bit here, where he actually goes into an enclosure. So the middle note is being played by the flute, by the third flute, which I find interesting. And we should say that it's flute three and clarinet one in the first bit. For some weird reason, I didn't write that. So I'm going to go flute three, clarinet one. So we do have a mixed timbre effect on one of those stacks, basically. So instead of flute one, flute two stacked, and just clarinet one, clarinet two, the flute actually starts in the beginning, and possibly because it is going to go into three voices at this point for that reason, rather than the clarinet. But it's interesting because, of course, would you not perhaps have the clarinet and do that? But we have bass clarinet lined up a little bit later on, although there's nothing, it doesn't play, it's tacit, so it could be that they didn't have the player, just didn't book it, and I wonder whether that was an orchestrational device to save money. I don't know. It's an interesting one, but anyway, clarinet one, then flute, then clarinet two, so we actually go not within sort of normal range where flute would usually be over clarinet. So that's an interesting thing, a little enclosure just for one little beat. And then flute stacking, flute one, flute two, flute three. And then flute three shares the same note as clarinet one does, and then clarinet one and two just appear as they always did all the way through. So that is that little bit. So I'll play it again for you. And you can see how the celeste just doubles those notes at the unison. So don't forget the celeste sounds an octave higher. Also got a glockenspiel on that B as well, a little triangle. Interestingly, the celeste doesn't play the E flat to D. And then it carries on the Q, which I have done before. And I will look at strings, and I will look at, you know, other bits of the orchestra as well. So sorry if it's a little bit frustrating that you don't get to hear the whole thing. But, you know, I've already done the breakdown. So the rest of it is just right at the very end, but we've got this really fun bit, which is very reminiscent of the asteroid field in the next film. In 4M2, the asteroid field, bars 158-163. It's slightly different where it is in the stave at that bit, and slightly differently voiced, but it's a similar idea, that sort of da-dum, ba-dum, 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 sort of drifting away type sort of thing. And that is kind of right at the end, I think. I thought it was. Maybe it's a little bit further on. So where have I said it was? Bar 26, the princess appears. It's because I was on the wrong thing. So right at the very end. So after this, as it drifts away. And interesting, again, you can see that we've got a mixed timbre. You know, why not clarinet one and clarinet two on this bit? And I think it's just, you know, just providing a little bit of contrast with what we had before, which I think is rather intriguing. You know, why not clarinet two? And of course, it's doubled with celeste, and we've also got that little glock and the strings pedal A. So it sort of ends pretty much in the same way that it starts. Which I think is an amazing little sort of motivic ploy or orchestrational ploy, which doesn't get looked at very often. But it's a sort of interesting device that we've got the same timbre pretty much all the way through. Bookending the cue. Then we've got Lost R2, which is essentially binary sunset. So I'm going to close this down because otherwise I'll get confused over which score I've got. And the bit I'm looking at, really, because I'm not really looking at melody at the moment, I'm just looking at harmonic outlines. So it's this interesting bit here where we've got flute one, which plays the full half note, full minim, but then we've got bassoon, which is just playing the first little bit. So we've got a little decay on that note, and really all it's doing is it's emphasizing the first note of this pairing here in the harp. We've also got pedal tremolo strings as well. There's a lot of tremolo strings, by the way, in Star Wars generally. And of course, that's what that is. So this is how it sounds. And of course, the flute sings through because of the fact that it's low, and it's not fact it's low, it's because it's quiet. But we get this really nice mixed timbre of flute and bassoon, with bassoon one actually quite high in the register, but not playing melodically, playing harmonically, which is an interesting one, really. And of course, they're just doubling that transient that's picked up by the harp. A little bit later on, we get that beautiful horn melody. I noticed that the original horn player passed away recently as well, so... which is a real shame. My father played with him quite a bit in the 1970s and 1980s. Anyway, so he plays this beautiful horn line. And then we've got an interesting bit. So this is all harmonic roll and a little bit of sort of counterpoint. So if I just play that, you can see that it's taking over the viola and the cello. Viola's divide. then they take on a melodic role. So eventually they'll play the melody. In fact, just clarinet one and clarinet two play the melody. Got an interesting sort of trebling of the root. Notice that I'm just looking at woodwind at the moment, and notice how the flutes take over that melodic role. So there's a little bit of melody going on here. Breaking into a harmony on the change of chord, on the E flat chord. And again, we've got another Brahms going on here, which is this figuration. This one's slightly different. It's the full octave, so thumb and fifth finger, but now the first finger on the lower bit. So it's not going like that, which I find interesting. I think I've missed that bit. There we go. So it does go into a Brahms properly, sort of thumb, fifth finger, third finger, basically, as if you were playing on a keyboard. But what I find really interesting is that the melody sort of slightly interferes with the oboe because it's sharing the same register, but it still works because we've got, and it doesn't happen very long, but we've also got, of course, it's supported by strings, so that's the first thing. But also we've got the flutes coming in as well. But look at how the oboes slightly interfere with the melody. But because it's a different timbre, slightly, so double reed but then clarinet, it works quite nicely. So that the timbres themselves, so we've got double reeds on the sustaining instruments here. So if I take it from... Let's also take the third clarinet as well. So it's a bit more of a blend. Like that. And then in short score, it looks like this. So we got clarinet one, clarinet two. Doubling the viola trem, doubling the VC trem, clarinet three, doubling the VC trem as well. Then block chords. So here in the lower wind, we've got bassoon one, two, and three just stacked. The third clarinet joins the top note. In this case, it's the usual root, fifth, third, and then the extra voice is taking the fifth as being double. And you get this sort of rather nice warm sound. That's a particular sound that you often get in tuba, bass trombone, trombone one, trombone two. That sort of thing as well is quite common. And then again, it keeps the same sort of formation. And, you know, who worries about consecutive fifths and octaves? Nobody. And the oboes are also taking that those two upper voices as well. And then they're all by themselves at that point. That's clarinet three, I think. Although, actually, no, it's not. It's bassoon one. So that's another slight error that I made there. I didn't label it properly. So you've got clarinet doing the melody and then oboes playing that as well. So let's just hear those. And it's interesting, actually, with the violas as well, it's a really extraordinary divisi a four. I mean, that would only allow two players per voice, which is really extraordinary. So if I just take that and the violas and nothing else, not even the horns. Let's take the cellos as well. Let's take the cellos as well, because it's another harmonic role, really. So it's a blended orchestration at that point as well. So just a sort of really an interesting example of mixed textured melody dominated homophony. So in other words, melody and an accompaniment, but how the oboes now play the harmonic role rather than the melodic role, and at some point they are higher than the principal melody, but because the melody is played on the violins as well, because it's blended in this case, it's absolutely fine. Notice that the violas are below the strings at that point. But also we've got horns, So again, I'm not going to play the bass bit, but just so you can hear the melody. Yeah. So the only real interference is at that point where we've got the semitone, like that, which is interesting. But it seems to blend quite nicely. And even with the... we've got that going on as well. So there's all sorts of slight, you know, overlap, basically, which I find really intriguing, because I think when you're writing a melody and a counter melody, sometimes it's quite difficult to know what to do. And really, there is no counter melody. It's just chords. So maybe that is a thing. Maybe sometimes it's good just to keep it as simple as possible and let the melody shine through as much as we can, and just keep the chords there. Notice how the horns move: quaver, crotchet, 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 quaver. I'm not supposed to be doing brass today, but there we go. Anyway, it's just sort of interesting. And of course, we will go through it even more at a later date. But at the moment, I'm focusing on winds. So, yes, anything else that I think I've missed? I don't think so. I put flute one on the high note, but flute two and three on the lower one, possibly because it's quite a low register, so it requires two instruments. So you don't need the two instruments on the top voice, especially because it's the melody as well. So that's another sort of consideration. And of course, it breaks into flute one, two, and three at that point as well. Don't forget, flute one, two, three, and then oboe one and two. And then we've got the clarinets as well. I think that was it, clarinet one and two. So that's another slight error. Always good to check these things, isn't it? And that's it for now. It's another short one, but again, I really hope it's useful, because these sorts of things can often get really sort of overlooked. Especially in one's own work, and I'm guilty of it too. And sometimes I think, oh, you know, I need to make sure it doesn't interfere with the melody. But sometimes it can, as long as it's simple enough to kind of be accepted, because of course this is just going with the bass line. It's just, you know, a chord just going up. But notice how the double reeds mix with the bassoons, and then you just got one clarinet in the middle as well, just for sort of security, which I think is sort of rather interesting. Notice that the oboes are not also playing what the horns are. The horns are below the principal melody as well, so that's another consideration. But I'll do brass another time. We'll probably have a look at the same sort of thing, but from brass and then strings, and then focus on everything at the same time. It's just sometimes it's very difficult to just focus on everything, because that's not a focus. So anyway, hope you enjoyed that, and I will leave that for you at the end, so you can have a quick look at it. Great. Thanks very much indeed, and I'll see you again soon.